When I teach human evolution, there are three questions I'm often asked by students. These questions are not easy questions. They deal with what many would consider a highly controversial and sensitive concept. So let's talk about them a bit. Paraphrasing, the three questions are basically, can we breed humans into a super species? Are modern medical interventions causing us to be less fit as a species because we're letting those with genetic disabilities reproduce? And lastly, why worry about cleaning up our world? Won't natural selection take its course, causing humans to adapt? Of course, these are very sensitive questions, in part tied to concepts of eugenics. While this class is unable to go into the moral and historical issues that these questions present, I feel it's important to address these questions at least from a genetic perspective. So, can we breed humans into a superspecies? Let me first remind us that humans already have low genetic diversity for a species, so additional inbreeding programs are probably unwise. But putting inbreeding aside for a moment, could we engineer a superhuman species? We first need to know what exactly is superior. If you knew exactly what that species was going to face in the future, especially the deep future, then we could engineer a path to withstand that storm as much as genetically possible. But that's the hard part. We don't know what we might face in the future. Being athletically fit might seem like an advantage, but what's the consequence of low body fat when there's sudden food famine? That's tricky, isn't it? You see, reproductive advantages are context-specific. They depend on the environment you're in. What might be an advantage in one environment could be absolutely disastrous in another, and we have no idea what to expect. We already mentioned an example of this, skin tone. Without modern interventions, light skin has a major disadvantage in areas with strong UV irradiation. A more classic example, one tied to health, would be sickle cell anemia. Sickle cell is considered a blood disorder. I encourage you to read about it here. People who are carriers for this trait are resistant to malaria infections. Not surprisingly, because of natural selection, the sickle cell trait is in high frequency in certain populations in Africa that are heavily burdened by malaria. This also raises the question, are these carriers of the blood disorder unhealthy? Well, not if malaria is around. This is what's fascinating about thinking of health from an evolutionary perspective. An unhealthy trait is environment specific. In other words, humans could try to breed superspecies, but their definition of what is superior will likely have no relationship to how the environment is going to impact that species in the future. So instead of engineering superhumans, maybe instead we should just limit the passing of traits that are clearly unfavorable. This is basically our second question. That is, should we let people with known genetic disabilities reproduce? But then again, what's unfavorable exactly? The sickle cell? Certainly not if our future involves malaria-like outbreaks. Also, in general, you never know who out there might be carrying a special trait that saves the species. They could be the child of the rock, or children of the brilliant Stephen Hawking. By the way, Dr. Hawking has three children, three times as many as the rock, so better fitness there. So this leads into our third question. Basically, should we place our faith in natural selection? Should we ignore the environment and climate change and pollution and toxins? Because in the end, won't natural selection cause us to adapt to this new, albeit dirtier place? This might seem like a silly question to some, but it's a very thought-provoking question to me. And the answer is, well, maybe, but probably not. We first need a reality check about species. If we look back in time, we see that very few ancient species got to serve as ancestors for future generations and new species. So these ancestors represent the smallest fraction of species that have existed. The vast, vast majority of species that have ever existed have gone extinct, leaving no descendants behind. Extinction is normal, and humans are in no way removed from this system. In other words, the story of natural selection has largely been a story of persistent failure, with success limited to a very lucky few. We can't trust that natural selection would save us. Natural selection certainly has not earned that trust. If we wish to continue to thrive as a species, we need to save ourselves. That said, sometimes natural selection does work. But let's think about what that actually means for people. Several years ago, my colleagues and I did a study in the Andes of South America with a community that was a copper mining town. This community was experiencing very high infant mortality, which is the rate of death of children under the age of one. High infant mortality means babies die. It's also known that this community was exposed to high levels of arsenic in their groundwater, likely because of a lack of regulations in local mining. High arsenic has been associated with various illnesses, including cancer, cardiovascular disease, and importantly, high infant mortality. Yet this wasn't enough to demonstrate that it was the arsenic largely connected to the community's high infant mortality. So we used a study of natural selection to help us out. We found that this population, over generations, was also experiencing a major change in the allele frequencies to a gene called AS3MT, which is a gene known to be involved in metabolizing arsenic in the human body. In other words, the population was evolving in response to arsenic. So this being said, should we let natural selection take its course? After all, the community is adapting. Why mess with it? Well, let's not forget that not all adaptations will be successful in the end. But importantly, while this community is adapting to a degree, it's only through great, great suffering. And they're adapting to an environmental condition that is preventable and temporary. It's needless suffering. The cost of letting natural selection take its course when it's easily preventable is that more babies die and more people suffer needlessly. Now, once mining stops because the copper output is no longer profitable, or once regulations are in place to clean up the environmental contamination, this selective pressure will end. The suffering, in the end, will really be for nothing.